Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Gagnon Atelier. Gagnon in this. Well, welcome to the show, everybody. We are glad that you are here. We are broadcasting live from Gulf Coast State College in the Education Encore program. I have got right in front of me, behind you, a beautiful classroom filled with awesome students. So everybody, go ahead and give yourself a round of applause. We're so glad that you're here. Coronavirus ain't stopping us. We still have class. We're not scared of nothing here in Florida. That's right. But so we're excited. We're doing it live from Gulf Coast State College. And today we have a wonderful guest with us. It's going to come on and talk to us about his career and his art and all the things that he does for artists. He is really, truly a mentor to a lot of artists out there. He would be what I would call a father figure in the movement, and he has done so many great things for the art community and continues to do so. And so he is going to be coming on and talking with us. So if you got your masks on or if you don't, that's okay. We are ready to go. We are going to bring on my new friend, Eric Rhoads. Hello, sir. Welcome to the program.
Hey. Thank you, Tim.
All
I'm
right.
Glad to be here. Hi, everybody.
Look at that. You got a round of applause. Rock
well,
and roll.
That's something that happens every day.
There you go. Well, I am so glad that you came on the show. I've been trying to get you on the show for quite a while, and this is a real treat for me. One of the things that I just I watch you every day as you do. You do a daily broadcast where you interview artists, you talk about everything and anything in the art world that would affect artists, from business advice to marketing to, you know, painting technique and all kinds of great things, as well as you publish two of the biggest magazines in the art industry, and as well as you host a bunch of events and conferences and things like that. So you're a busy, busy man. And we appreciate that you can come on and join us.
Oh, I'm honored. Are you kidding? This is great. Thank you.
Rock and roll. Plus, you're getting interviewed by like Spider-Man here, so it works out pretty good. I almost wore a Spider-Man mask today, but you know, my wife talked me out of it, so I went with an almost Captain America look. So, which is pretty good. Yeah. I can only stop fogging up. You know, it's one of those things. I got all these, you know, it's hot in Florida, so I get foggy. But so tell us a little bit about yourself and a little bit about, you know, your career and what brought you, you know, to such a focus on art in general.
Well, I was not an art person. I had, I always had a little bit of interest in art when I was a kid. I used to, my mom was an amateur artist, and so I kind of hang out with her a little bit. But essentially, I was an entrepreneur, and I spent a better part of my life in the radio industry, on the radio and then owning radio stations and then founding an internet radio company and some things like
Wow.
that. And I
would not know that with that perfect voice.
And I, when I was about 38, 39 years old, I went to the art store and I picked up some art materials, some acrylic paint, I think. And I started trying to paint from some pictures, and I was really frustrated. I was not able to get what was in here in my head onto the canvas. And so, I tried and tried and tried experimenting. I just couldn't do it. My paint was globby. I just didn't know what I was doing. And so my wife bought me an art lesson for my 40th birthday. And
wow.
It was at the Armory Arts Center there in Florida in West Palm Beach. And so I went into this class, and the guy said, just express yourself, you know, throw the paint on the canvas. And it was basically an abstract art kind of a thing. And I said to the guy, you know, this is not what I want. I want to learn how to paint actual things, like, you know, an object or a flower or, you know, something. And he says, well, nobody does that anymore. That's old school. That's over. That's what I want to learn. And he said, well, nobody can teach you that anymore. Nobody teaches it. And I thought, well, that doesn't compute. So I quit the class and I gave up painting. I put all the art materials away, and I probably waited another year or 2 years. And I got stuck in a taxi cab for an hour one day, and the taxi driver was an artist. And so I told him the story, and he said, well, there's a guy in West Palm Beach by the name of Jack Jackson, and he studied in the lineage of the artists who were in the lineage of Jerome in France. And so he said, you need to go to him. He can teach you how to do what you want to do. And because I didn't want to get bad instruction. So I waited a year because I was intimidated by it. I remember being in the parking lot my palms were sweating, and I was nervous, and I wasn't sure if I was going to go in or not. And I kind of got out of the car, and then got back into the car, and then got out of the car. And here I am. I'm a successful business guy, and yet I was totally.
That gives me hope. That gives me hope.
So I was totally intimidated, and I walked into the class, and I remember this moment, that exact view. I could see all the easels. There were about 15 students. Most of them were women, and most of them were retirees. And they were doing copies of old master paintings. So I walked in, I saw what they were doing. And instead of being inspired, I said, I can't do this. And I turned around and I walked out. And I walked out, and thankfully Jack noticed me, and he said, hey, come here. Why are you here? How can I help you? And I said, well, I told him the story, and I said, but I can't do this. And he said, you can do this. I said, I don't have the talent. He said, you don't have to have talent. You need to learn. He said, if you can follow a recipe, you can learn this. Yes. And I said, I don't think I can. He said, no, you can. He immediately said, come here, let me show you something. So he immediately got me on a project and started me out. And from that, I was able to, I spent, you know, a couple of years with him, and it really changed my life. And I remember there was a defining moment for me, and that was I was on a business trip in San Francisco. I was trying to start this internet company, and I was on this business trip, and I went to the Museum of Fine Arts in San Francisco, and I saw a Bouguereau painting in person for the first time. We had been copying Bouguereau. We'd been learning from painting, you know, pictures and posters. And when I saw it, and I realized, I could see the depth, I could see the veins under the skin, and I realized that to accomplish what he accomplished was unbelievably remarkable to me. And I just teared up, and I stood there and I cried in front of that painting. And that was the moment that I realized that I was going to devote my life to art.
Amazing. Isn't that a great story? I mean, it really is. It's nice to, you know, people think that as artists, we have this special magical power that we're born with. And you know, they don't understand it. It's a skill you can learn. Yeah, that's true. But the, you know, it's like, I like that. Well, one of my favorite quotes, and God help me, I can never remember who says it. I know it's a sportsman that actually said it, but he said, hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. And that's always.
That's exactly right. You know, in my job, I get to meet, like you do, I get to meet lots of artists. And that's the one thing that the great artists have in common. There, you know, there are some people who have natural born talent. We were talking about an artist that you know who was in art school with you, who was a little bit more experienced, or maybe a little bit better. But chances are it was because she worked really, really hard as a kid or a young person, drawing all the time, copying things all the time. And as a result, you know, it's that hard work that really sets it apart.
It really is. And we can actually say her name because she comes on the show every now and then. We're talking about Shannon Levinson. And what I love about Shannon's work is she keeps posting, and I use it in my classes here all the time. She will post a piece of a self-portrait that she did when she was going to the academy with me. And it was like 2012. Yeah. And then she'll post a self-portrait that she did in 2020. And she puts them next to each other. And the jump in skill level is so massive. If you haven't seen that, I'll have to email it to you so you can see. But
I have seen it.
And then I always put that quote over it, you know, the whole hard work beats talent. Because one of the things about Shannon that I do love, and every artist that is of a certain level, there's a work ethic that they have that is absolutely insatiable. They work, they're workhorses. They put the time in. And my friend Matt Tommy has a saying, and one of the things that he says is, you can't expect professional results with hobbyist habits. And so if you live your life as a hobbyist attitude, you're never going to get to that professional level. You have to have those professional practices to get you to certain skill level, I think.
Well, there's even professionals that I know, good friends of mine, who, you know, they've been hardworking, but they, and they, you know, they work hard on their careers and they put the time in, but they get to a point where they get comfortable with their work and they don't grow. And, you know, if an artist isn't growing, you're going to lose the passion for it at some point. You know, for him, it was almost like a manufacturing job. He would just sit down and manufacture paintings, and he had a great way for selling them and a good system in place. And he was making a good living. And I took him plein air painting one day with me. I said, you need to get out. He said, no, I've never done this. I don't need to do it. I'm happy where I am. And all of a sudden he started growing, and you could just see this guy, you know, he lit up and he said, oh, this was so much fun. And you know, and his work got better. And I think whether we're amateurs or whether we're professionals, growth is so satisfying. You know, that I always say that plein air painting is the new golf. And the reason I say it is because it's social. You get to be with other people. You're outdoors. But most importantly is you're challenged. You know, I know people who painted. I know an artist, Ray Strong. He painted till his day of his death at 102. He painted from a wheelchair in the last few years of his life, but every day of his life he was outdoor painting when he could, and it kept his mind sharp. It kept him enthusiastic. And of course it was also very social. So these things really help us stay alive and stay strong and vibrant and make us better. And so growth for any artist, whether they're a hobbyist or a professional, is critical. That's why I do all these videos, is because I, you know, not everybody has the opportunity to go study with somebody like you, but you know, if you're sitting in a small town somewhere and you don't anywhere in the world and you don't have the opportunity to study under a great artist, at least you can, you know, hit the play button on your internet, or you can hit the play button on your DVD player and have an opportunity to learn. And, you know, it's not as good as in person. In some ways it's better than in person, because, you know, sometimes we hear a concept and we don't catch it, but the second or third time, it's like I read books sometimes three and four times and I catch new things every time. Same with art instruction videos.
Oh yeah, that's the, you know, the rewind button is a beautiful thing. And then you can see, you know, it's like, when you take a workshop, a lot of times you're like, how did they do that? Like, what was that brushstroke they did with a video? You can just rewind. And you have produced and had on your show so many great artists, you know, over the last, just in the last 6 months that I've seen. It's just been tremendous to sit there and watch the discussions and talking with them and watching videos. You produce quite a few videos. And that's, I'm going to share this. Go ahead.
Well, go ahead. What were you going to say?
What I was going to say is I was going to share the screen on your website here. And you can see here, if you go to videos, there's quite a few different videos that you guys offer. And this is in addition to what's on your Facebook presence as well.
Yeah. Well, when I finally got into this, I had purchased some videos and I watched them and I didn't love them. And the reason I didn't love them is because they just, first off, the quality wasn't great. The audio wasn't great. You know, there was noise in the background and the lighting wasn't great. And there was reflections on the canvases. And then there were, you know, you didn't get to know the artist because it was just video. So I started a little video thing because I wanted to get something better. And, you know, we built a studio and we bought, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of professional equipment. We hired guys from Hollywood. You know, we did it right. And we started producing videos. We have well over 400. And these are like full length courses. Some are 10 or 20 hours. And so we have like 400. So when COVID hit, I wanted to do something for everybody. First off, I thought I wasn't going to survive this financially. I thought, you know, all my artists are not my, the artists that we work with weren't going to survive financially. And also everybody needed something to stay occupied and to not be focusing on COVID because, you know, we're stuck at home. We need to be, you know, if we're sitting around worrying, we're not making ourselves healthy. And so I thought I'll come on every day at 12 noon on Facebook and YouTube and I'll do something. I'll do art marketing. I'll do artist interviews. I'll do artist demos. I'll do something. And then every day at 3 o'clock, I'm going to give them a sample of these art instruction videos for an hour. And we have literally seen millions of people view these now, and we've done it 6 months in a row without a day off. And it's just, you know, there's a time in everybody's life where you have to step up. And I realized that I sat around for a week and when this was all going on, and my brain was like, I need to do something for these people. What do I do? And finally I said, well, I'm just going to go on and I'll go on every day and I'll talk to them. I'll try to comfort them and make them feel better and keep them enthusiastic and teach them about art, give them something that's a distraction. And so, but I thought I was only going to do it for a couple of weeks, but I made a commitment. I said, as long as, you know, we're in quarantine, as long as COVID's going on, I'm going to be there for you. And so here it is, it's 6 months later.
All right.
And, you know, and it's been every day. I mean, not having a day off in 6 months and having to take sometimes 2-3 hours a day to prep. And, you know, I've got 3, 4, 5 people working on prep and getting people arranged and, you know, doing graphics and things like that. And it just, it's taken our focus off of what we do, but it's been the right thing to do. And it's been a good thing for it. You know, some of the artists have said to me, you know, I hadn't sold a painting, but I made some money on this and, you know, you really saved me. We had people say, you know, I wasn't able to always buy these things, but you're given a discount on them every day. So I've been able to get some. And then of course I had laid off 10% of my staff and we all took a 10% pay cut. And because this has worked, I've been able to basically bring everybody back to their normal salaries and bring some people back. And so it's been kind of a win-win for everybody.
Oh, that's fantastic. It's definitely been a blessing to watch the videos. How can they now, if they go on Facebook, where do they find these videos that you're producing every day?
Well, I would say the easiest thing to do is to go to Facebook or YouTube and put the word Streamline Art Video in the search. And that'll show up, right? So if you follow or subscribe, then if you have your browser open, it'll show up. And when we go live, it'll say, hey, Eric is live now. And so that's probably the easiest way, Streamline Art Video. And
Streamline Art Video on YouTube, yeah, if you search that.
On YouTube. Yeah, and hit the subscribe button. That way it comes to you automatically.
Right. So if they go, if
yes,
you guys
thank you.
Watch this, those of you that are in a class, write it down. So basically go to YouTube, type in Streamline Art Video, and you'll come up. And then, of course, subscribe and hit that bell notification, as always. So that and they are very good. I mean, I know that I'm a big fan. I watch them pretty much every day. And again, the beauty of YouTube is if you miss the live broadcast, it's still there. And you can watch it, you know, for perpetuity.
Or you can watch it again.
Yes, or you can watch it again and again and again, which is a great point.
Yeah, no, so, we're gonna at some point we're gonna pull them down. We'll keep them available to the people who subscribe, but we're gonna put them behind the subscribe. So if you subscribe, you're gonna have full access to them.
Right, that's fantastic. Now you had mentioned you know, your love for plein air painting, and you actually do publish, one of the magazines that you publish is a plein air magazine. I'll go ahead and share the screen again so people can see. You're the publisher of Fine Art Connoisseur magazine and also Plein Air magazine. Let's talk about your love for plein air painting, because it is one of my loves too. I matter of fact, we just last week we did a live show where we my friend Rob Woodrum, who was, it was his first time plein air painting. Like you had said, an artist that's been, he's been an artist. He actually taught me how to airbrush 30 years ago.
Plein air painting for the first time, even for an experienced artist, isn't easy.
No, it wasn't. And we painted the Hathaway Bridge. And so, you know, it was we were underneath the Hathaway Bridge, and it's this big S-curving giant tilt-up concrete structure that serpentines across the bay. And it was it's a challenging, I mean, I've done a lot of plein air painting. It was challenging, and he just fell in love. He fell in love. So tell us about your love for plein air painting, and what is it about it the most that you absolutely love about it, and a little bit about the magazine too.
Well, again, there's a story behind everything, right? Lori and I moved out to the Bay Area. I was starting a .com. I started some technology which is being used today, even on this broadcast. I mean, YouTube didn't exist at the time, and so I was busy, and I was running this company, and you know, trying to raise money, but I always wanted to keep painting, and I was painting in the back bedroom in this house we had in the San Francisco area. And my wife got pregnant, and we have triplets, and she got pregnant with triplets, and she said, you know,
all the women behind you just freaked out.
She's a saint. So anyway, she said, look, you're going to have to give up painting. And I said, why? And she said, well, because you're going to be a dad of three kids. And I said, look, painting, for me, a day without painting is like a day without oxygen. I have to paint. I'll find a way. And she said, well, you can't paint in the house because I can't stand the smell. She would get nauseous. And so she said, you're going to have to go to the garage. And so I moved everything down to the garage, and, you know, which isn't ideal because the garage is cold in the wintertime, and even San Francisco gets cold. And so I go down to the garage and I get everything set up and I paint down there. And she said, no, that's not going to work. I can still smell the paint. And so thought, well, I have no other choice but to go outside. I did not know that plein air painting existed. I never stopped to think about it. I now remembered, you know, Monet painting outdoors, but I never saw anything like it. I didn't know there were people who did it. I didn't know there were special supplies. So we lived on a golf course. And so one Saturday morning or Sunday morning or something, I took a box, a card table, a chair, a studio easel, and just a bunch of stuff, a big canvas. And I went out on the end of the golf course. We had a really pretty view. And I set up and did a painting, and it was a disaster. My painting was awful, even though I wouldn't say I was a good painter by then, but I was decent. But my painting was awful. And, you know, the bugs were bothering me. The painting kept flying off the easel. You know, it was not a fun experience, but I was painting. And so I kept doing it. And then I went into an art store in Walnut Creek, and there was a notice on the bulletin board about a thing called a plein air show. And I didn't even know what plein air was, but it was said something about painting outdoors, and it was in Martinez, California. So we went to it that weekend, and I met my first plein air painters. One of them was Randy Sexton, who you may or may not know. And, I went up to this guy and I said, how do you do this? His work was really beautiful. We bought our first painting, and he said, well, you've got to go out and do 100 small paintings, you know, do 100 of them, and don't try to, you know, take too long, give yourself an hour, do 100 paintings. And so I went back, and they all had these outdoor easels. Most of them were open box M at the time. And, some of them used French easels. And so I went out and I bought a French easel, and tried that, and I did my 100 paintings, And I, anyway, I started learning about it. And then I learned about an event. There was a workshop or something where there were about 100 painters gathering. And so I went to that with my wife and the babies. And I learned a little bit more and more. And so I thought there was a movement. I thought, you know, because there were 100 people there, I thought this must be a movement. And so right. Because I was making my living as a radio magazine publisher in the radio industry, I thought, well, I'll start a magazine for plein air painting. And so I made up a dummy cover and I went around to, there were only two or three plein air events that I could find out about. The internet barely existed. And so I went around and I showed this magazine. I got a lot of encouragement. I thought there was movement. So I launched Plein Air Magazine, and that was in 2004. And of course, since then, we launched the Plein Air Convention. I launched these retreats where painters come and paint along with me and others for a week in beautiful places. I've got one coming up in New Hampshire called Fall Color Week. Yeah. Which is coming up, and I do one in the Adirondacks. And then I've done international trips. There's no workshops. We just paint together. You know, it's a lot of fun. We sit up at night. We do portraits. We sing. We play music. We have fun. It's like summer camp for adults. And so we've done Cuba 2 times. We've done New Zealand. We've done Africa. And we're doing Russia in September of 21.
Oh, wow.
And so it's just like, I've kind of, my staff says, you're Walt Disney, you know, you've created Disneyland for artists. You know, the whole idea is to give us all something fun to do, something that is get, you know, painting is social. You know, we all get isolated in our studios and we don't have anybody to talk to, but when we get together, we find out they have the same problems we have, you know, and so we make these friends and they become lifelong friends. And then we end up going to events together. So I do this convention, which is, you know, gathers about, probably this next one in Denver in May will probably be about 1,200 people if we're allowed. And we all set up every day. We have training indoors. We have 5 stages, you know, watercolor and oil and pastel and everything. And we have 5 stages. And then we go from that and then we go outdoors every day and we all paint together. So it's like 1,200 of us painting together in a beautiful location. It's really cool. And so we do that convention. And then I also because I started out with this guy from this atelier in West Palm Beach, my first love was portraiture and figure painting. And so I decided to start, Plein Air was a successful conference. So I started one called the Figurative Art Convention and Expo. And that turned into a successful conference. We'd bring in the top masters, both the tight ones and the loose ones, so right. People could kind of choose what they wanted. And then from that, this year we were forced into virtual conferences. So we did a virtual plein air thing called Plein Air Live. And we had, a bigger audience than we get in person. We are coming up in October 20th. We're doing one called Realism Live, which is 5 days. And I've got, I don't know if you heard this or not, but I've got Odd Nerdrum, which is the great master like Rembrandt in Sweden or Holland or some of Norway, maybe. 20 top master artists that are, you know, the top tier cream of the crop artists teaching for 5 days. And we have the first day is a optional beginner's day. And then we have all these brilliant artists. I mean, you know, Dean Mitchell and Daniel Sprick and Juliet Aristides. And the conference is all that. I realized that I had become very narrow. When I was figure painting, I was figure painting. When I was plein air painting, I was plein air painting. But I realized that if I'm a painter, I need to get good. I judge art shows. Like I just judged the Art Renewal Center show. Mm-hmm. And one of the things there was a painting where the figure was really, really good, but it was a figure in a landscape and the landscape was really awful. So that painting didn't get a high mark. there was a painting where a person was in a room and there were basically still life objects around the room. And the painting was the still lifes were really bad, but the figure was really good. And so that led me to believe that I have to help people refine all their skills. And so I put this conference together. So it's got figure painting, portrait painting, still life painting, landscape painting, plein air painting, floral painting, basically all the subjects. And then I got the best of the best in each of those subjects, both the tight ones, you know, like Daniel Sprick is very, very tight, but very stylized. You know, Josh LaRock is very, very tight and very classical academic. And then you've got people like Rose Franson, who, you know, she's wild and she's loose and she's fun. And so I wanted people to have choices and to be able to get a sample, you know, of demonstrations and you know, really serious stuff from each of these people. So it's 5 days of intense study. And people, when we did it with plein air, this one woman, Elaine Miller, said to me, she said, I got a better education than I did in 4 years of art school. She said, you know, I went for my master's of fine art. She said, I got more of a master's in 5 days watching the plein air convention. That she said, I immediately signed up for the, it's called Realism Live. I immediately signed up for that because I got so much, because it's concentrated learning and you're getting all these different thoughts and these different ideas and these different opinions and, you know, see how different people paint. And then you get to choose what works for you.
Yeah. And that's really one of the great things about your, when you go to a conference or the ones that you're hosting, when you bring in that level of artist, you know, and they're giving you, you know, when they're doing a demo and they're explaining and they're talking the whole time they're painting and they're explaining the reason they use that brush, the reason they use that technique, the reason they're using these particular colors and how they work together. You learn more at a conference than you do in years of study sometimes at a college. You know, sometimes when you're in a college and you're getting your program, you're just cranking out art so fast because you're doing assignments. But when you get to watch a demo and sit there at a conference, you're absolutely right. The level of the intensity level of the instruction my wife was a ballet instructor for years, and they would always go to these things. They were conferences, but they called them intensives. And I always thought that would be a great way to describe what going to an art conference is like. It's like an intensive.
Well, when we do live in-person conferences, it's an intensive, plus you have the social aspects. You get to meet people, you know, at the FACE conference. I don't know if you've been yet or not, but, you know, you could sit down with Stephen Assail or Jacob Collins and meet them in the bar and hang out with them and talk to them and ask them questions. We tried to keep the conference fairly intimate. We're going to do it again next year in 21, fall of 21 in Williamsburg, Virginia, which is a really pretty area. And the, you know, but with COVID, we couldn't do that. But I wanted something that would give us the opportunity to still have that interactivity. So the interactivity comes from we take these breaks and we put people into breakout rooms. And so they're meeting artists. We've got artists attending for 30 or 40 countries. We have faculty members from other countries. So we're putting them in these breakout rooms and they get to meet with and talk with for 30 minutes. Different artists, and they make friends. And everybody who first signed up said, I'm not sure this is going to work. And then afterwards, they said, it worked great. It was really great. It was almost better than a convention, because rather than standing there in a cocktail party hoping somebody talks to you, you're put into a room with five other people, and you're kind of forced to talk to each other. And so that worked great. And then we do live painting at night. So at the end of the day, each day, because we want to cement the ideas in your head that are, this is what I learned today. You want to put those things right to work. And so we do live painting at night, and we call it the cocktail hour. And so some people will just be on talking, and some people will be talking and painting. And then I just kind of go randomly through the hundreds of people and just start talking to them. And we get to observe each other and get to know each other. And we get to see their paintings, and, you know, it's a lot of fun. And then on top of that, we put together a private access Facebook page. And so now everybody's staying in touch, mm-hmm. you know, from the plein air live. And so everybody's developed these relationships with one another. It's really terrific.
Yeah, they do. You know, when you have such a, you know, you bring in people together, you know, it's one of my models in life is if I'm the best artist in the room, I'm in the wrong room. And so to be put into a room where, you know, one of my favorite Bible passages is iron sharpens iron. And yeah, so you right. be around like-minded people that can take you to the next level to improve and to grow and to be all that. And when you get thrown into a situation like that, it's like diving into the deep end of the swimming pool. You're either going to swim or you're going to drown, but you're going to grow and you're going to get better.
And like we said before, growth is so important and everybody needs to grow. And, you know, some people will whine and they'll say, you know, this is too much money. And yet it costs, if you were to go to my FACE conference, get on an airplane, rent a car, get a hotel room for 4 days, you know, you'd spend $3,000-$4,000. You could. And by the way, people are happy to do it because they're getting so much out of it. And yet it's worth about 10% really of is. That. So for about 10% of that, you know, you're getting all these people. And plus I'm able, because of our contacts, to get people together, but also because of coronavirus times, I was able to get people I normally couldn't get. So this is not like do it next year. This is like do it this year, because I can't do replays on this. You know, everybody who attends gets replays, but I can't sell it. It's my agreement with the artists. I can't sell it to people after the fact. And so this is like, do this one now. You know, it's going to cost you, if you do the beginner's day, it's going to cost you less than a couple $100. And yet, I mean, yes, I know people sometimes will pay $25 for an art class, but if you had 1 hour with any master painter, it would change your life. Just 1 hour. And I got 40 hours of content for a couple, you know, just a few $100. I mean, it's really a good deal. And so you just say, okay, I'm not going to go to dinner with my spouse, my husband, my wife, you know, one time this month, and the amount of money you'd spend for dinner and a couple glasses of wine, you could have, you know, 40 or 50 of the greatest masters in the world.
Right. Now, where can they find the information to get involved with this?
They should, if they're watching this before the 30th of September, they can save $200. The price is going up after the 30th, and it's at realismlive.com.
I am putting this on the screen, realismlive.com.
Yeah. I would love, I don't know if you want to do this or not, but I'd love to field some questions from your audience.
Oh, that would be great. So what I'm going to do is, anybody out here got questions?
Well, I just want to compliment in the series because I've watched a lot of them, and it wasn't just because of coronavirus. I was looking for tutorials, and they're excellent. I mean, I've met a lot of artists.
Can you hear her? Could you hear her?
I don't hear her as well as I hear you. Well,
come on up. I'm going to turn the camera around so you can see. There she is.
We're going to blame the mask. I just wanted to say thank you for doing what you did with the videos, because I've enjoyed so many of them. I haven't counted how many I've watched, but it's been a bunch. And I love the portraits. I've even watched the landscapes, because I agree with you. You can have a beautiful figure, but if you don't know how to paint a tree in the right shading, you know, you didn't do anything if it's in the backdrop. So thank you so much. It's been great.
Oh, that's very sweet. Thank you. What's your name?
It's Laura, and I'm one of Tim's best students. Meaning I keep coming. Yes. I keep coming. That's what I mean. That's what I mean. But I'm working really hard, because I'd like to take all of my painting to the next level, and been painting for about, I don't know, 10 years, and usually recreationally. But now I'm like, I feel that passion. I have to do it. It's important to do it. So
yeah. And do you have a plan to eventually sell your artwork?
Oh, definitely. One of my sons is a marketing computer guy, so he's bothering me, and pretty soon I'm gonna, you know, get my act together and get some materials to get online. So eventually, ask Tim, he can tell you.
Oh yeah, she is She is absolutely one of my top students. We use her as an example of hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard. And she is a workhorse, and she has grown incredible leaps and bounds as an artist. And actually, her son is the one that made all of our headers and all of our videos for the show. So that works out pretty good. So good job, Lucas.
Oh, so because they're in the advertising business. Well, you could make some for my show too.
There you go.
And just know that I teach art marketing. I spent my life building businesses, and so I hate the idea of people seem to think it's a badge of courage to be a starving artist, and nothing could be further from the truth. You know, Van Gogh is a starving artist because he was mentally ill, but anybody can live their dream, and it's a matter of two things: mindset. And I noticed your friend there, that I didn't catch her name, but she has the right mindset. She's confident. And so mindset, and then looking for, there's so much access to the world's best experts in anything. Whenever you can get the world's best, you know, you don't, if you're in marketing, you don't, you don't go for somebody who doesn't know marketing. You go for somebody who's the world's best. If you want to learn about changing your mindset, you go to Tony Robbins. If you want to learn about painting a portrait that looks like Rembrandt, you go to Odd Nerdrum. You know, so and you can get access to these people through things like this. I teach art marketing. I've built some massive businesses, and I use techniques that no one teaches for artists, and so I have a blog called artmarketing.com, and I have free content there. I also have books and videos and all that stuff. But if you go to artmarketing.com, you can get, a real good feel for some things you can do to kind of break in and ease in and turn yourself into someone who sells their work. And, you know, some of you might want to just sell it, you know, make an extra $100 a month, or some of you might want to make an extra $100,000 a month. And so it's all possible, no matter what age you are. You know, I'm not one that believes that age has any restriction. As long as I can talk, even if I can't move, I can function. And so I'm not giving up. I hope to hope that I'm blessed with, you know, many, 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 many more decades of ability to help people, because there's so much to do. And nobody should give up just because of their age.
I agree with that. You know, I always tell my kids it's the mileage, not the years. But, it really is. You know, it's like I always look at, like, you know, Moses was 80 when the burning bush talked to him. So there's hope for me. I'm way younger than that. But, it's never too late. It's never too late. And, you know, especially as an artist, there's so many artists that you know, started late, and they have wonderful, thriving careers. And you're right about the starving artist being a badge of honor. You know, it's very interesting to me about you know, that whole mentality that artists sometimes can have. And it's not hard to be a thriving artist. You just have to do the work and change your mindset a lot of times. So it's really cool that you've got that art marketing as well. And I've watched a few of your videos on that.
I have a couple of big goals. One of them is, the one thing that disgusts me that I hear frequently is, I wanted to be an artist and my parents told me to get a real job, that to get an education and something so I could support myself. I hear that more than anything else. I intend to change that. I am working on a program. I'm going to put art marketing in every art school in the world. I'm going to make art marketing available to everyone studying art. And I'm going to find a way to make sure that everyone knows that you can become anything you want to become. I have artist friends. You have artist friends who are multimillionaires. You would never suspect that they're multimillionaires because they don't flaunt it. I have artist friends who have 3 and 4 homes and drive nicer cars than I drive, and they're making tons of money doing art, and they're teaching, and they're happy, and they're selling art. And in some cases, their art is selling for $250,000 for a single painting, in some cases more, it's possible. And it's, I don't like this, but I could take a bad artist, and I'm not saying this to sound arrogant. I could take a fairly bad artist. As you know, there are bad artists who are world famous.
Yes.
And I could take a bad artist and turn them into a multimillionaire in 5 years. And, but imagine what you can do if you're a good artist. And so, you know, the most important thing is to get really good at your craft, really study, get better and better. And at some point, there's a point at which you go into the market and you're ready. Sometimes you're not ready and you've got to get ready. But then from that point forward, you can really do anything. And I put together a video. It's called How to Make a Living. I don't remember what it's called, actually, but it was designed for people over 65. It was designed for people over 65 who say, I don't have as much time, and how do I make a living as an artist? And so I did a whole video about that, how to make a living as a full-time artist, even if you don't have time, or something like that. And so, you know, there is, anybody can do anything at any age, you know, with the limitations of, you know, our health. And so sometimes our health gets in the way. But if you're doing something you love, your health is going to be better, typically, because your mindset is going to change. And that's going to keep you healthier. You're going to get more exercise because you believe in yourself and you believe in what you can do. You're going to take better care of yourself.
All right. And that's great advice. You know, I think that, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I'm mentoring with Matt Tommy right now. One of the things he's always talking about with mindset is you got to get rid of all that stinking thinking that people are telling you and start focusing on
that's it's true.
Stinking thinking.
Yeah, the stinking thinking, you know, to get that.
Stinking thinking.
Most important thing first, and then when you get rid of that mindset, change it, and you think positively, and then you start working on your skill set, and it starts happening, just explodes.
Yeah. Yeah, so she's
don't pay attention to all that stinking thinking.
Yeah, the stinking thinking will get
I heard her, and there's actual evidence. They've now been able to study this and be able to study the brain, and for it takes five positive thoughts to overcome one negative thought, and you and think of it like a bank account. You're building a bank account of negative thoughts. And to get those negative thoughts out, you have to do five times more positive thoughts. You've got to push them out. And as long as those negative thoughts are in there, you know, whichever your account has the most of is what's going to win. And you have to train your brain to do this, because our reptilian brains, I learned this from Tony Robbins, our reptilian brains naturally default to the negative to protect us. And so you have to work hard to push that negative stuff out and focus on the positive.
That's really good advice. That is really good advice. So are there any other bits of advice or tidbits of information? I do want to show your websites here for the magazines, outdoorpainter.com and fineartconnoisseur.com. Can you tell us real quick, obviously outdoorpainter.com is about plein air painting. What is Fine Art Connoisseur about?
Well, I wanted to create, I love art magazines. I buy all the art magazines. And I wasn't happy with what I saw. And so I wanted a magazine that was for art collectors. But I found that art magazines at the time I started them were a little bit too highfalutin for my taste. You know, it was almost like they were trying to hold something over on us. I wanted to be something that was a little bit more friendly and open. I have a friend who literally is a billionaire, and he refuses to go into art galleries because, you know, he feels intimidated by it. And I think we need to change that. So I'm trying to make art more accessible. I'm trying to make it's an educational vehicle. It's you know, we talk about historic art, we talk about contemporary art, we talk about, you know, it's almost all realism. We don't do abstract in that world. Other people cover that world really well. And it's really just to make art help people become more aware of what's happening out there and to make it more accessible rather than to be snooty, quite frankly. I have, there's a couple of places you can go to. We do so much. I mean, we have four newsletters in art. We have two magazines in art. We have two conferences. We have three virtual conferences. We're just launching Realism Live. We did Plein Air Live. We're launching Watercolor Live. We're launching Pastel Live. We're going to do an art marketing thing live virtual. But we also are, you know, we have three video companies. We have a TV channel on Roku, Apple, and Amazon. We have, products, all kinds of different things. And so we have all of that. If you go to streamlinepublishing.com/everything, you can see everything that we do. And we have a lot more that we're about to announce. We're very busy people. We have a lot going on. And the goal is to, like I said, create Disneyland. And you can also find most of it at ericrhoads.com, which is, you need to hit refresh because that's the old website.
Oh, is that the old website?
I think, well, maybe I may be wrong. Okay. Well, I guess we've got a new one that's coming anyway. But if you go to streamlinepublishing.com/everything, you'll find it, or go to ericrhoads.com. You'll find it.
Okay. Excellent. Well, thank you very much for coming on the show. I really, really appreciate it. One of the things I've said in the beginning, you are, for a lot of artists, myself included, quite a mentor, and a father figure that we can look to grow and to learn. And you've provided so many things. I like how you talked about your staff calls you the Walt Disney of the art world. That's pretty cool. I like that. That's really good. I like that analogy.
Keep in mind, I'm not saying it. They're the ones saying it. I don't.
Right. They're the ones that are saying it. It was like when Laura said she was my best student. I agreed with her, but it made her look. So yeah, she's blushing back there. She's blushing pretty hard, but she is one of my best students. But that's okay though. When your staff says that, that's a good thing. That means that they're seeing something in you that's a good thing. And I would have to agree with that. The more that I've watched your videos and looked at your websites and different things that you do, the more I see that. And so that is definitely a correct and accurate statement from your staff.
Well, the goal, making money is nice, and we do make a little money sometimes. I mean, not so much this year, but the goal is to give people education, inspiration, help them get to the next level, and to provide them things that are going to be fun for them, because art has to be fun. I mean, we used to play with crayons because it was fun, and it needs to continue to be fun. The minute it stops being fun, then why do it, right? So I think that, my goal is to give people things to do, give people social context, help them make new friends, and just kind of bring people together. And that's what this is really all about. That's the mission for the rest of my life, is to really see how far we can take that. And the best thing you guys can do for me, quite frankly, is you can share my stuff, tell other people about it. We've been having lots of people from all over the world watching the 12 noon on Facebook and YouTube and the 3 p.m. on Facebook and YouTube. But when you share that stuff and you tell other people about it, I've had people come on since COVID and say, I didn't know how to paint. I never thought I'd be a painter. I just saw, one of my friends posted this, and I just watched it, and it got me inspired. I went out and bought some art materials, or got on Amazon and bought them, and I started painting. I've had people say to me, I painted when I was, in college, and, now I've gone through my life, I've raised my kids, I gave up on painting, and you re-inspired this. The goal is, if we can get more people painting, we can change the world. I have a goal of teaching 1 million people to paint, because I think if I can teach 1 million people to paint, it's going to change the hearts of 1 million people. They're going to be more focused on doing good things and beauty, rather than focusing on the negativity that we're seeing in the world today. And when I get to that million, then I'm going to add another million to the goal and keep keep doing it. So the best thing you guys can do to help in this is to share it with other people if you think we're doing good work. If not, don't share it. But I think the idea is if every one of you guys can help teach another person, you know, if you're out plein air painting, somebody stops and talks to you, put the brush in their hand and give them a mini lesson and try to help them find some interest. Because if you can get them convinced that they can do it, the words I always say are, you know, people walk up to me when I'm outdoors painting and they'll say, I wish I could do this. I don't have any talent. I can't even draw a stick figure. They always say those things. And I say, if you can follow a recipe, if you can learn to type on your keyboard, you can learn to paint. And let me show you how. Let me give you a lesson. I don't care if I mess up my painting. I want them. And I'll say, here, mix these two colors and you'll get this color. Now take that and do a brush stroke like that. And they do it. And if I get them doing it two or three brush strokes, they're like hooked. And I'll say, you can do this. You can learn this. And that's what we all need to be doing.
Amen. That's absolutely correct. You know, in this time, it's like everybody's worried about, you know, we focus on the negative of COVID, but there has been a pandemic, but there's been some great opportunities. And the internet is, I wish I would have had stock in Zoom. That's all I got to say. But technology has allowed us to do so many great things, to bring so many people together and allow right. people to learn new skills and to learn new things. And so in a lot of ways, it's been a blessing also. So, but again, Mr. Eric, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you.
Yeah, we're going to close. Stay on the line here real quick, though. I'm going to go ahead and close the program out and all that. And all right. We'll come back on with you in just 1 second.
Thanks, everybody.
Well, everybody, for those of you that are watching online, we're going to let you go as well. But we thank you so much for coming on. Wasn't that a great episode? I'll tell you what, Eric Rhoads, check out all of his websites and maybe you can be a part of some of the great things that he is doing. We appreciate you coming on. Next week, we are going to have Steve Bennett and Dr. Schmidt from the Bennett Collection. They are world-class art collectors, and they have a great program that basically focuses on women artists. And so we're going to have them on next week on the Modern Masters Podcast, broadcasting live from Gulf Coast State College Education Encore Program. And so with that said, guys, just remember, as always, God loves you, and so does your old pal Tim. We'll talk to you next time.